If you will consent to burden your soul with a vow that you should never make and a knowledge you should never dream about, I will promise you in return...
You will promise me in return...
I will promise you a very entertaining evening.
Your offer is far too idiotic to be declined. Permit me here and now to promise as a good comrade and a fellow artist that I will not report any of this, whatever it is, to the police.
On this episode, we welcome Brina and Peter from Sons of Silver into Thunderlove Studio for a chat about their upcoming album, Runaway Emotions. Sons of Silver brings a unique blend of experience and raw energy to their music. Their sound is a rich tapestry of classic rock influences mixed with modern sensibilities, all combined with a passion for storytelling. It's this unique sound that makes Sons of Silver one of the more compelling and exciting bands on the modern rock scene. We covered a lot of ground and had a great conversation, so sit back and relax. Here's our conversation with Brina and Peter from Sons of Silver.
It's just the normal noises in here.
I gotta tell you, I've been practicing for a year. It was about a year ago that we first met. And I think I got your name down.
Joe. Ah. It's just Joe. That's the only hint you get.
Peter Argyropoulos.
Argyropoulos.
Pretty close.
Damn it!
Well, if you were in Greece, it would be very close. That'd be Argyropoulos.
I don't even say that. Frankly, I didn't even change my name. It's Brina Kavler. She's a handful.
She's a coward.
Well, thank you guys for joining.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thanks for
Same rules as before. You know, you can say whatever you want, curse as you want. If you see me glance over, it's only because that's where my notes are.
That's cool. If you hear a little screaming in the background, it's because our 3-year-old got home. He's
at the park right now, but you never know when he's coming home. He knows we're in the guest room. We're in the room where he's not to play, but
you are now the third married couple that I've spoken with.
Wow.
Yeah.
The Dolly Rots.
Oh yeah.
You know, it's funny you mentioned that because I texted Kelly.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, well, so Dana, because I'm sitting here thinking, how do I take a 3-year-old on tour with us? And she said, hey, Kelly's been doing it for years, right? So I texted Kelly saying, hey, you know, when's a good time to talk? Because I know that obviously they're parents and they're touring and they're busy. And so I called and we arranged a time and I called her, but she didn't remember that phone number was me. So she, you know, didn't answer because that's what we do. Right.
Yes, it is.
we don't answer anymore. Uh-uh. And then I texted her and she's like, oh, shoot, that was you. But it turns out someone who I recorded for a long time is now their drummer.
Simon.
And so it's a small world. Yeah. And I'll probably call her, I don't know, in the next week or two to kind of pick her brain as far as how they do it, you know, and take a little one on tour.
Yeah, they have two of them, I believe.
Yeah.
Two. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then a band called Bad Mary. They're out here on Long Island.
Okay. I've heard of Bad Mary.
They're similar to the Dolly Rots, that same sort of power pop punk vibe. Okay. But yeah. check out this band. They are a husband and wife. The woman's father is the drummer, and their old college professor is the guitar player.
That is amazing. Whoa. That's amazing.
Whoa, that's interesting.
That's a good little family there.
Yeah, it is. And they make great music. And I was like, how do you handle the conflict? Right. You know, a potential conflict. I mean, you've got father, daughter, husband, wife. I don't know the dynamic between a college professor. I was never that close to them. So that's why they would never want to be in a band with them.
I was going to say, that sounds a little kinky.
No judgment. No judgment here. Do each their own. Speaking of conflict, as a married couple, how do you guys handle conflict when it arises? And how do you...
Right, next question.
That's fair. It's fair.
Well, I think that... all right, you have two spaces, right? We have the studio, mm-hmm. and we have home a lot of the time, unless you're touring, and that's a different thing. So there's the studio space where most conflict would happen, I guess. And then there's the home space. And a lot of times when you go to work and you have conflict with your coworkers, you can go home and have some distance and, you know, let off some steam. But we don't have that. So I think we've managed, may I say, I feel that a big, big part of us doing this and succeeding is that he's really good at coming to me and saying, hey, let's talk. So he's
excellent. I say, let's talk. I'm the boss. The buck stops here. You see that door over there?
Yeah, yeah. No. I really doubt that.
I'm an only child, and so I'm used to having space to go and sit with my emotions. And so I will definitely take the space if I can, and I might do it for a day or two. Okay. But that's not good, right?
Doesn't mean we don't speak for a day or two.
But that's not good.
You can down the road a little bit.
So instead of letting it fester, if we are butting heads, you know, for a day or two, he comes to me and he says, hey, let's talk. And that kind of breaks it open, and it always is a healing process. So I'm going to just say, like, one of the biggest things is that he really comes forward and is always the one to say, hey, let's talk if, like, we're really, you know, butting heads in some way. Yeah.
Don't worry, Peter. I'll cut it all out and make it sound like you're a badass. I'm not a sweet, sensitive guy.
Well, I just do what she says. And, it's you know, she's got it all together, you know.
I just cut the grass.
Take out the garbage.
Yeah.
There's another element too. A lot of times after we do most of the tracking with the band, mm-hmm. it's down to Peter, Kevin, and I a lot of the time, like for the production. And Kevin is a saint. Like,
he's making it like we battle. We don't battle,
but I'm just saying he is so good at just
conflict management
and like reading the room, and like just he's so good that he adds that extra pleasure, you know what I mean? So
he's got a real silent zen to him.
Yes,
he does.
Yeah. You know, I noticed, I remember that from last, and I listened to the interview again today. I'm like, wow, he's really just chill.
Yeah
and he's really smart too. Very aware, very astute. He's one of our best friends for a reason, not just because we're in the band together. He's a great guy.
Yeah.
But it does. And it's funny too, on that note, like, because as Brina was saying, when we're going to overdubs and stuff, right? It's not primarily the three of us. And again, you know, as we've mentioned at other times, Adam, our bassist, will chime in. We send, you know, rough mixes, ask for ideas. And likewise, you know, with our drummer, Mark, same thing. Mark probably he's more involved, like send me something. So every couple of days I'm sending him stuff, but they keep their distance because they know if there are too many cooks in the kitchen, it makes things hard to move forward. And our general roles are that Brina's engineering, you know, Kevin and I are doing a lot of the playing, but I'm more the overseer, like sort of the supervising producer, but we're all producing. But it's interesting. You would remove any one of us, and of the three of us in particular, when we're in the room doing overdubs, and it kind of starts feeling a little like, oh, I don't know if this is, you know, it feels weird. It's hard to move forward. It's almost like you need that combo to get it done. Even as a band, there are a couple of times where we've been like, okay, you know what? Such and such is not available this day, but we really need to practice some. Let the four of us go in. You know, we don't do that any longer because we just sit around and like, it just feels weird. Yeah. Feels like, well, yeah, but this is all great in theory, but you bring the other person in and the dynamics, the chemistry will be completely different. And we may go, instead of going left, we might go right, might go up instead of down. You never know. Right. So it's the same though, again, in that overdub situation. And finally you get to a point where you just embrace it. It's like, okay, this is what it is. And frankly, most people would probably be really thrilled to have an arrangement like that. Just, you know, so.
Yeah. And I'm not going to make the same mistake I did last time and ask, you guys really perform and rehearse and write in the same room? Because I do think it translates to the music very well. And you've all just mentioned that you write and record and do everything in the same room. For those that haven't heard Sons of Silver, tell us about that indescribable vibe that you were just talking about of all of you in the same room that exists when you create together. Mm. You know, like, tell me this is a great example of this energy that you have that translates from the recording to me, the listener.
Well, I think Adam, to borrow from Adam, our bass player, I think he's put it best in one phrase, which is that what we do is very reactive. So if we were, you know, any of us were presented with, let's say, the same song or the same idea for a song, on our own or in separate little groups, we might handle it one particular way. But then when you get us all together, it's going to be different because not only are we playing ourselves and playing for each other with each other, but we're also reacting to what each one of us is doing. And in reacting, what we're doing is in reacting, you know, to what each of us is doing, there's this constant change of dynamic, constant change of direction. And at the same time, it's a refining process. So what people are really hearing is, frankly, it's four or five people playing together. And I say four because often Brina is actually engineering while the other rest of us are all tracking, but she's still chiming in. I like this. I don't like that. You know, how about maybe make a change here, speed it up, slow it down, you know, or here's a different melody, Peter, blah, blah, blah. And so it does circle back to the five of us. But really we're just, you hear five people actually working together, trading ideas, sort of almost like a kitchen throwing around different, how about this one? Here's this one, this, and putting all the different ingredients in together, and then this is what you get, and then we clean it up a little bit afterwards. And
but you know, may I say there's another element too. Oftentimes I've noticed,
wait, back to our original thing. No, you may not.
there's an element.
How was that? Was
where
that, the tough guy?
It was okay. I think we might have to get you a teddy bear. Whoever has the teddy bear can talk.
Zip it, will you?
Where I've noticed, okay, in the past, we got to work a lot of the songs out live. Like maybe we're on tour and we play some of the songs live, see the responses, see what feels good, what doesn't. Obviously during COVID we didn't get a chance to do that. Right. And so it was a unique experience with Mark, the new drummer, and these new songs and the album to come, where we didn't do that. In fact, it was like, okay, write the songs, get them done in 2 days, you know, maybe. And we didn't have the same opportunity to sit with them until later. So what happened is we recorded them and then we sat with them, and then there actually became an opportunity to perform live. And so we went back into the studio with Mark, and we got to sort of for the first time play these songs that we recorded in the studio. And it kind of brought to light what worked and what didn't. Because I think that until you can really play them live together and you know them and you aren't thinking too much, and it's just, how does your body feel? How does your heart feel about it? Mm-hmm. You understand, you know, that's not quite right. Or that transition doesn't feel, or I don't really like this guitar lick, or I don't like the way the drums feel, you know? And so we got to play them live together. And then we went back in and did tweaks. So I think
actually, that's slightly incorrect. Sorry.
Production tweaks. Sorry, tweaks.
We recorded everything. And then we got a call, hey, you want to play some shows? Went and played some shows. And during that time, we rehearsed a lot with Mark, grew a lot tighter, Mark, mm-hmm. our new drummer.
Yep.
And then he came to me and he's like, you know, look, I know we cut all those tracks and everything. He said, but I want to do them all again if it's cool with you guys. And he goes, he's like, you know, just whatever it takes. He said, if it's studio time, he's like, I'll pay for it. He said, I just want to do it again because now I feel like I'm really part of the band. So that's part of that, you know, reactive thing. Like Brina said, also playing him live. So, you know, to answer your question more in a more less roundabout, less politician type of way, you just hear people playing together, sharing ideas at the moment, and hear what the outcome of it that is, but just a little cleaned up at the end. That's really it, you know.
And having fun.
Yeah, and having fun. And we don't do anything. If we're not having fun, we pull the plug real fast. Doesn't mean we won't come back to something, but if like tell me this is a great example. You know, that song kicked around for a few months. We got a little bit here, a little bit there, a little further. And then we're like, you know, it's not quite happening. Shove it aside. And revisited it several months later with Mark. And it just, boom, it was done. And the ideas we ended up with, they all came really fast, 20, 30 minutes max. And at the end, you know, to put it all together, because we had pieces and we had a riff, we had chorus melody, kind of, we had a lyric. So that's part of the whole fun thing. And we're not the only band like that. There are a lot of bands. I mean, for God knows, you read about the Beatles. They were like that. If it wasn't fun, they'd can it within 15, 20 minutes, you know? So, but that's what people are hearing. And I think that's why a lot of, you know, times we're now, people refer to our style of music as neoclassic rock, because it's new. It's a new sound, but it's also borrowing from some of those artists of the past. And I don't love the term, but I understand where people are coming from. It's not as contrived and slick and produced, you know, to the nth degree as a lot of acts are now.
And to be fair, we do that on purpose. Like even in the mixing stage, every mix engineer. So normally I would mix it, or we would all mix it together. But with a 3-year-old, that's to have that attention span and have a 3-year-old is not going to happen right now. So we had to find someone who, by the way, we found Tim, and he's amazing.
Tim Palmer.
Yeah.
What a treasure to find. And I think to be able to work on that stuff and to have vibe and to really, how should I say, like to just enjoy the time, because it's a short amount of time that we had together, because we do have a 3-year-old, and it's kind of like, okay, we have 5 hours instead of what you would normally pick, 12 hours, maybe 10 hours. And so we focus pretty hard, but we also have fun and we vibe off each other and we enjoy it. So I can't imagine any other way, honestly, doing it. If we were doing it in individually, that would be hard, because it would.
Oh, I couldn't do it. I would do it. I mean, it's just, it wouldn't be fun and it wouldn't sound very good. It would be fine. It would just be kind of, whatever.
The one thing I love about the record, I only got one. I had the 4 tracks that you sent over, which were great. And then I got one quick playthrough through the whole thing. It hits. Every song hits, except for the last one, obviously. Friends is a little bit slower, but it's just punching. It's relentless. I love it. It's
awesome.
It's not something you hear very much. And so this is my question. It's kind of a nerdy, eggheady question, so bear with me. How do you balance that reverence for the stuff you like and the stuff that's influenced you with an absolute imperative to do something new? How do you reach that delicate balance? Because it's clear I can hear stuff from the past, but it's not. Yeah, I can say it sounds like this, it sounds like this, but it doesn't sound like that. It sounds like you guys.
Lack of skills.
Nah, come on.
No, I mean, in this sense, look. Okay, first, your limitations, I should say. Everyone has limitations. I first of all, my voice. I have a deep voice. Most lead singers aren't baritones, or really, I'm more of a bass. Mm. And so there's that helps create a definitive sound, which is something we have to always work around. How aggressive do I become? In particular, Breen and I work on that, but the whole, we all discuss it. Is this the right key? So during our rehearsals, we're constantly monitoring, is it the right key for my voice? Because that'll affect what people play, even the bass, you know, because if we change the key, maybe he's not able to go up high on the neck and play some notes that he would, you know, might play if it was in a different key. And then that changes sort of the dynamic. And obviously, likewise with the guitars, keyboards, and drums. So that's one element. The other element is that, you know, for instance, I've had friends in the past who are phenomenal players in the sense of you just show them anything and boom, they can play it right away. And I'm not that guy. I mean, I can sound out the chords real quick. I have a great ear for that. But as far as playing, you know, a little more intricate guitar parts, keyboard parts, not me. And perhaps the rest of the guys in our band are more like that. But even then, no one's really interested in that. So you have those two factors, and then add in the fact that we just want to get in and do our thing, which is in the sense of just have fun together and see what we come up with and chase whatever idea we have. What that lends itself is to our influences that come out within each one of us, and there's a fair amount of overlap there, and then just the sum of the parts, really.
Yeah, that's
my take. Now she may have a different one, but debatable.
No, I hear what you're saying. It's interesting because we had a questionnaire recently where each person in the band, member of the band, was asked what's their top five favorite artists, albums. Mm-hmm. And you really got to see on paper that there is overlap for sure, but slight differences between each person. And I think that is a lot. Or has a lot to do with it because, okay, we all love overlap. We all love Radiohead. That one for sure. There's an overlap of U2. There is an mm-hmm. overlap of The Clash. There is an overlap of, those are the main ones.
I would say Radiohead number one, Clash number two, U2 number three of the overlaps, the major overlaps.
And then there's a lot of other stuff, you know, like Adam probably, I would say, is the more
rock
guy, classic rock.
Black Sabbath, Zeppelin.
Which is really good because I think he kind of...
pushes in that direction a little
bit. Yeah, it brings us kind of in the realm of less eccentric, you know? Because sometimes, I'm a Radiohead Fugazi...
She's the hardcore one of the band.
I'm totally alt rock, you know, okay. Girl.
Misfits.
So I'm like, let's get weird, right?
Yeah, yeah.
and then Kevin is wonderful because he has these beautiful guitar ideas. I mean, sure, The Edge and U2, but also the Verve.
Mike Campbell.
And Mike Campbell.
Tom Petty.
So. Yeah, mm-hmm. Very textural. So he brings all these beautiful aspects to it. Yeah. And he's probably the more refined, you know what I mean? Like his timing, everything.
It's I don't know, more than Mark or Adam.
Well, and Mark, I'm talking about his taste. And then Mark.
Oh, yeah.
Mark's
a punk guy.
Yeah, Mark's a punk guy, which is great. That's where Tell Me This actually finally, how you know how he said he kind of put it on the side. And then Mark came to the table and he came up with this punk rock drumming. And it just really brought it to life.
It was just more his energy.
And his energy and everything. Yeah. So, but he's also very involved and refined too.
Yeah.
So it's interesting because I think we all have the music that is in us, what made us want to do this for a living in a way, but we kind of balance each other out. And then I think it comes into the collective kind of having its own sound. Back to what you were saying.
If I may throw in one more thing, the other thing I would throw in is that one thing we all love is we like music made by people. And I mean that in a really straightforward sense. We all like music that's made by a people without a whole lot of machines, if any machines involved, as far as, you know, it's not to diss drum machines or anything like that. I love all that stuff. They're great tools and everything, and they're great for certain artists. Like, I love Depeche Mode, one of my favorite acts, right?
Yep.
But for us and for what each one of us likes to create personally and then within the group is we like that sound of, you know, a little bit of Rolling Stones in there, a little bit of that Train about to go off the tracks, not nearly as much as they had, but just, you know, maybe just made my people. It doesn't have to be perfectly coiffed.
So right. Right. I said this, I may have said this last year, and I think it bears repeating again. What I like most about your songs is that they seem to be the right length. They seem, there's nothing superfluous in them. They're the length that the song needs to be. You don't hear an extra verse. You don't hear a guitar solo at the end that teeters off into nothing. You know, it's just like these really punchy songs. You've got lengths from almost 6 minutes down to just under 3 minutes. I mean,
thank you.
Again, that's shit you don't see very often today.
Well, you would hear it more than us, because frankly, I don't listen to a whole lot anymore. I listen to pieces. So I mean, is that you really hear that people, things go on too long a lot in the rock world, at least? Or
uh-huh. Yeah, I think so. I think there are some songs like, all right, enough. And that could be my own temperament as well.
It is your own taste. That's what I mean. No, I mean, I don't mean in a bad way. I mean, it's like, that's what, yeah.
Well, I'll say from the engineer, as you said, normally I'm in the engineer seat until we kick into production mode, and then I kind of go back and forth. So I get to kind of be in, you know, the perspective of, okay, where is this song going? And I do have my say when I feel like I need to, but it's really nice to watch the guys work on that. And they, from my perspective, are very aware of what you're talking about. Especially Adam's really good at that too.
Yeah.
Hey, I feel like this is too long. What's the point of this point or this section?
Okay.
Well, that's actually a very common discussion in the songs. Like, do we need this? Can we lose it? Should we change it? And it's very much a part of the development of the songs.
But we also strive not to be throwaway either. Like a lot of artists are just going for more of those quick 2 minute 30 songs now and like that, which is totally cool. It's very retro, so to speak, and and we're aware of that. But frankly, on this album we have some longer songs. We have quite a few, and we were to a degree we were just letting it happen. It's like that's what was coming out, and we did shorten some of those a little bit, but we did feel like, you know, it just wants to be a bigger statement. And we feel also that for live, it's good to mix them up, because, you know, if someone's just hitting you with a bunch of fast quick songs, it's like an assault. And and after a while, it's like a Rodney Dangerfield gig. You know what I mean? After a while, you're just like, well, this is great, but I just need a moment here to step outside, you know? And likewise, if you have a bunch of long songs and you end up being like a big jam band, and that gets sleepy. So we try to find a balance, you know, and we think of it also not just within the collection that's being put out, let's say within an album or an EP, but we also think about it long-term with the catalog stuff. So let's say, okay, like right now we could go out and play a 90 minute set. Mm-hmm. You know, how's the ebb and flow going to be with all the songs we have or that we'd want to use? Is it, you know, are we going to be able to have a nice up and down pace and, you know, and things like that. So I appreciate hearing that, but
I think that speaks to the whole vibology. Oh, that's a horrible, the whole vibe that you guys have, you know, I think it translates now. This is going to be, I'm pinching a little bit from Matt Pinfield. I watched that interview as well. And during that interview, he name checked the Manic Street Preachers in reference to running out of words.
Uh-huh.
It's lyrically. What I noticed, I got stuck on, what did I get? Nobody Minds.
Oh, yeah.
I got stuck on that song. It was like a repeat like four times, because there, I'll try to connect it now. Inadvertently, you sound like the Manic Street Preachers. Huh. And that's like really, if you've never heard them,
you know what's funny? I must interrupt you real quick. I actually wrote it down that Matt mentioned that, because the interview's from, you know, about a month and a half ago, beginning of right around February 1st. Anyway, And I wrote it down. And then the other day, I was looking, we finally got a long form edit of the whole video because we discussed pretty much every song on the album. And I was looking for it, and I saw the piece where he brought that up. So I went back and started to listen, and I didn't get to complete, but I was like, it was like, wow, this is really cool. You know, it was different than kind of what I had sort of anticipated. So I look forward to hearing it. With that in mind, you know, I know he mentioned a song or two on there, but which song, if you want to remind me in front of everyone?
In front of the what song of the Manic Street Preachers?
Yeah, yeah.
No, no specific songs, just the sound of it. And yeah. they're one of my favorite bands. I don't know why they never broke here in the States, but they never did. But if you, I can't suggest the Holy Bible enough.
Okay.
Okay.
It is the sheer sound of somebody losing their mind.
Oh, I like that.
Wow.
I can't recommend if start anywhere, start with that record.
Okay.
I'm gonna listen to it tonight. I would say it's on tonight.
And as a punk gal, you're gonna love it.
Yeah. No, I'm really looking forward to it.
So, but you really caught it on Nobody Minds. I was like, wow, all right. I see Pinfield brought it up, and I'm glad he dropped the dropped that little seed. But
you know, I love hearing that too, because I'll be honest with you, that was a song that for me has been a little on the fence. I like the song, but mm-hmm. I was torn on it because I don't know. You know, when you sometimes you have a moment of reflection and you have the little doubt on it, but it's, you're not the first person who's, including Matt and others, who've been like, you know, I really dig that song. It really spoke to me the way it entered, the lyrics in particular, you know, and there's some nice ways in which the lyrics can, you know, because they're sort of politically charged a little bit, which they can be interpreted in many ways. And I like that because it, you know, keeps people guessing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm really glad to hear you dig that one, because that one's it's not out yet.
Yes. It's a great segue into my next question. And it has to do with politics. What do you think? And we can approach it from whatever medium we want to talk about. But what do you think the role of an artist is in these politically, we'll just call them charged or fucked up. We'll say fucked up, politically fucked up times. Do you think that the artist bears a certain responsibility to lend their voice, whether it's art, film, music?
I'll say this. I could totally dominate that answer. So you take it or you start.
You know, I have two responses, and one of them, I'm going to say is in one of our songs, and it's one of my favorite lyrics. Remind me exactly how it goes, but
wait. You don't remember one of your favorite lyrics?
whatever the song that gets you through the night, right?
Just getting started.
Yeah. Just getting started. But so whatever the song that gets you through the night, yeah,
whatever your name, whatever fight, whatever the song that gets you through the night.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And when I read that, because a lot of times, you know, when he's kind of close to the lyrics, he'll come to me and we'll go through them together. And I read that and it just hit me. So yeah, whatever the song that gets you through the night, right? Yeah. So my two responses are, as someone who deeply loves music and has so many songs that have gotten me, like I can think of, I listen to this song or that song and it takes me right to that moment in my life, right? And I know that's many of us, right? Or that got us through that dark time or got us through that hard time. And we all have them, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think in some ways, you don't have to have that responsibility. You just have to, your responsibility as a musician is to make what comes from your soul and then put it out there, and it's going to help someone get through the night. So in some ways you don't have any responsibility other than being authentic and being yourself. So that's your number one responsibility. If it's in you to make music or make art or make film, be authentic and put your heart out there and don't be afraid. So that's my first response. The second one is, if it's also in you to want to discuss it, then do it and be authentic in that.
Okay.
I agree. That sums up. The only thing I'll say is this, is that for someone like me, because that's exactly what I was going to say, but just much more eloquent. So, but, can I get a kiss for that? Later? you know, I would add that for someone like me who has a lot of strong opinions, you know, I have to be careful and I have to censor myself. But within those strong opinions, I would say my strongest opinion is being decent to each other, being kind, and you know, even if we're right at the edge of wanting to blow up, just trying to pull back. Yeah. And really sticking to a sort of basically to the freedom of speech. In fact, I was on a business call today with some label folks, and one of them was mentioning, I'll just be straight up here, how they live close to Columbia University. Mm-hmm. And with all the protests that are going on right now, and they said, he said, I'm really, really all for freedom of speech type of person, to the nth degree. He said, but we're crossing some lines here where it's getting belligerent, and it's not right, because it's getting belligerent to people simply because of their, in this case, religion, and that crosses a line. So that's something, you know, for me, where it's hard not to say something. I just don't want to just generally step in those fields, because it's so subject to misinterpretation, especially in today's world.
Yes.
It can be misconstrued. But I do have strong opinions in that we really need to do our best to respect each other. And I think that comes out in a lot of our songs. Mm. I think, you know, on this album, there are several songs like that. In their past, there are songs where I'll say, you know, this guy's coming from this guy, this person's coming from this side. At the end of the day, let's all just chill out. Remember that we have much more in common than not. And let's do our best to just get forward and get through these difficult times, because it is hard. There's a lot of change in the world. It's you know, there are a lot of things. I mean, look what these things alone have done to our lives. You know,
some good, some bad, but yeah.
Yeah.
So that's it. So we're all really struggling with that, and coming to grips with all these changes, letting go of the past, but not letting go of some of the past, opening our minds up to the future and our hearts up. But at the same time, you know, maybe saying we don't need everything that's coming at us.
May I add one more thing? And I'm just going to say, this is just from my point of view. I know not everyone shares this. As an artist, I see that a lot of art in the world is being silenced. In literature, in movies, in music. Yeah. And I find that scary. I find that very scary. So I think that I think it's good to speak out about keeping the opportunity for people to speak. Again, you have to be mindful of what you're speaking about and be open to people coming to you and having other opinions. But I do find, back to authenticity, I also find that it's really scary when society goes into a direction of keeping people silent and keeping art silent and keeping it
dangerous.
Very, very dangerous.
Let's not scare anyone. Let's not rustle any feathers. Let's not talk about the past. It scares me.
Yeah. So, likewise.
Yeah.
It's terrifying.
Yeah.
You know, nobody thought Fahrenheit 451 was actually going to end up being a reality-based book.
It is.
You know, slowly it's becoming that. Yeah. And one of the things that's on the top of everyone's mind is AI.
Yeah.
And I want to ask you guys, I know the answer, but I want to ask it anyways. Have you guys tapped into it for any creative resources? Now I'm going to
whole album.
God bless you. I appreciate the honesty. Finally. I mean, I use it as a writer. I use it. I'm not ashamed to say that I'll write something and I'll throw it in there and I'll be like, does this make sense?
And you'll type a paragraph, let's say, and you put it in there, and you'll ask it to critique it for you.
Yep.
Well, you know what? See, I think that, I mean, look, I'm not a technologist by any means. I mean, obviously, we're doing the things that in the music business, there's a lot of involvement with technology, you know, not necessarily the most cutting edge stuff, but it's just enough where you're probably further along than most folks. And within that, you know, I see AI as becoming an assistant. I see the positives. I don't really have a good grasp of,
we don't use it in our daily life. So.
Yeah. I tested it out, like with music video ideas, cover art ideas. And frankly, I found them all pretty lame. And I was like, let's just get a real human being. But I see the tools, and I'll say this, an interesting thing happened. So, a month ago, my dad had his 80th birthday. Mm-hmm. And, and it was a weekend gathering. But one of the elements was that of that was we got together at a restaurant with just his guys, just the boys. Together, my brothers and I, and there were about 15, 20 guys there, and some friends flew in from around the country, and they all had little speeches. And a few of the guys, I'd say actually probably like five or six of them, had AI generated speeches. And part of it was,
really?
Yeah, but they admitted it was, part of it was as a joke.
Okay, good.
They typed in a few lines, you know, and be it in, you know, poetic form or in more just basic prose, you know, or basic narrative form. And it was interesting because then we measured those. Everyone was measuring it against the ones that were written, you know, solely from the heart and from the mind. And the ones from the heart and from the mind spoke much better.
Of course.
But I will say we were all like, you know, mm-hmm. these aren't bad as Hallmark cards, you know? So we'll see where it all goes. But I think it has a role as an assistant, but, you know, to take over and create, no. I mean, doesn't that defeat the purpose at this point, you know, of a little, of like Paul McCartney would say, just like something that's a little more fuck upable, like a human?
Yeah. To that end, I use it. And one of the things I like to do is I like to put in questions and be like, all right, give me five questions to ask Sons of Silver in the voice of Lester Bangs or Robert Christgau.
Oh, dude. See, that's cool. That's fun.
That's really,
you're about to get a question.
Okay. All
right.
In the voice of Robert Christgau, who's like the bane of my existence. Not really, but. He's a little eggheady for me, as you will soon. To wit, a question I asked AR was, and they gave me five questions, but some of them were not relevant, like live performing, and I haven't seen you guys live, so I can't speak to that. But okay. I don't know how he speaks, so I will not attempt that. But your lyrics often pivot on disillusionment, threading through societal and personal despondence with a kind of poetic candor. What's the process behind your lyrical themes? Are they more a mirror to the world or a dairy left open on the table? A diary.
Wow. Wait a minute. What did you feed this damn thing? I got to know. What did you feed it?
Give me one second. Give me five questions to ask the band Sons of Silver in the voice of Robert Christgau.
That's it?
That's it.
That's amazing.
You didn't even give it any lyrics of a song or.
Oh.
Jeez. Wow. Okay, maybe it's a little more powerful than.
But it's able to go through all the lyrics and all.
Oh,
that.
Everything's out there.
Yep.
Wow.
Okay. And it turned it around, literally like that.
Well, you're fired.
Soon. I'd like to think I bring something.
My name is Keith Higgins, AI.
No, but it's really fascinating, and I love that. Okay. But that's a legit question. What's the process behind your lyrical themes?
It's just cathartic. I mean, frankly, it's just speaking in tongues a bit cathartic, making it's almost like humor in a sense where you talk about things that are somewhat verboten, and you do it in a way that's slightly ambiguous or slightly with a little twist of the tongue, a little twist in, you know, maybe a rascalish kind of humor. And in that way, it is cathartic because you're able to say things that you might not otherwise be able to say in public, and say things in a way that you have the last word effectively, because it's just me singing, you know? Yeah. And then also it's, the process is very, it's very reflective in the sense that it allows me to examine my own feelings and then present them in particular to someone like the gut people, to Brina first and foremost, because not only is she the one who's, you know, we're in the studio the most, but we have our private lives together. And so I'm constantly, to her detriment at times, just, you know, throwing ideas at her, I must say, and she's the best with it. Seriously, I appreciate it. There's never a moment where it's like, hey, can you turn that down or can you stop? It's always like, give me more, you know, or sort to our son, Julian, listen to what your papa's doing. And anyway, I detract. But what really it allows me a moment to reflect and refine my thoughts and reflect, because you know we all have these I feel like the world is good, but God. But when you really sit down and take a moment to figure out what you're thinking, you don't know what you're thinking. It's a little unclear. It's kind of ambiguous. It's a little imprecise. So this allows me some precision. It also allows me sometimes to think, you know, that's just not worth worrying about. I know, or this is important.
I will say too, we as a band, thankfully, it's just like a safe space for all of us to discuss. And I think everyone in their own way spends time keeping on top of what's going on in the world and reflecting on it. And so it's a safe space where we talk about it because we're all kind of in line, even though slightly different in, mm-hmm. in our viewpoints. So it's something just talking about the world and talking about our society and community, even like AI, like you're saying, you know, all of that we are always discussing. And it's really nice because I feel like everyone talks about the big and the small. Yeah. And Peter kind of takes that all in,
very much,
you know,
so.
About all our different angles. And so it's not just his viewpoint. I think that it is the combination of all of our discussions.
Yeah.
You know, seeping in there.
If I may interrupt that, and within that, you know, I'm always conscious that it is a band thing we're putting out there. So if there's something that maybe is on the fence to me, at the very least, I'll say to everyone, what do you think of this? And sometime, actually, there's never been a case where it's like, no, don't say that. But there have been cases like, well, you said it like this, but here's a different way to frame it. Here's a different perspective. And I'll be like, oh, okay. Yeah, that's cool. And it's invariably, it would be better. And so that's another way in which, you know, everyone has their stamp on the lyrics. And not because someone's necessarily just trying to get their thumb in the pie, but it's just that's part of the collective effort. And that's what makes it our the Sons of Silver sound.
Yeah, like if there was something he said in a song that really bothered someone, it wouldn't be in there.
No.
Okay.
You know, so we're all, nothing is in there that everyone isn't aligned with. No.
There are two other things I want to ask you. The first one is, I am smitten with your art. Who does your art? Who's your art director? I mean, it's just phenomenal. The title cards for Spotify, whoever's doing those are fantastic.
Which ones?
I didn't want to refer to my notes, but the last two.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, for Just Getting Started in and Tell Me This?
Yes. Those are amazing. And even the ones before then. But
well, Brina's our, what, you want me to take?
You are you?
To,
that's you?
I'm going to start this off.
Okay.
Brina's our art director. Okay. So she, I can, maybe in a couple of earlier things. No, you actually done a lot
I
of
used
the art.
To, when we first started, yeah. I actually did the art myself, yeah. like I hand drew it.
And then we passed it on to a graphic artist who would refine it, and Donnie Phillips who would refine it. But for the most recent work, we've been working with a guy named Alex Tenta, who's actually, he's well-regarded. He works at Warner Brothers. I believe he's head of the art department at Warner Brothers. Okay. Okay. And we were introduced to him by one of the folks at Universal because he also does private work, but he does a lot of fantastic artists. And so within that, Brina, though, you know, we discuss basic you know, goals that we're aiming for, but she will bring the ideas, and really those guys lead the way. And I kind of just sort of sign off or give the final thumbs up on things, but it's really, you lead the way.
The way the process normally, so there's Alex, and we'll put that aside for now. So before that, all the stuff previous to this album that's coming out and the singles that have just come out, we would work with Donnie, and he is great. And so what we would do, it was a collaboration. Like I would, you know, have a feeling about a song, and I have a Pinterest board, right? So I would put all these different ideas like visually that I had, and I'd send them the board, and then we would discuss it, and he would come up with some ideas, and then we, you know, we go back and forth with those ideas. And so he did, you know, he was wonderful to work with, but then he got really busy. So with our new album, we had to find someone different, and then we got led to Alex, and it's so wonderful because he does not just graphic design, but he also does stuff by hand. Mm. And he's also a punk rocker, you know? So all these like, you know, old punk rock album covers and flyers mm-hmm. and stuff, that's his jam.
But he also knows how to make them as they were made back in the day.
Oh yeah. And Xerox machines. And he can do refined stuff. So yeah, it's sort of like we just get each other. Like I just, yeah. I feel, same thing. I'll have my 4 or 5 sort of pins or art ideas that I'll send him, and I'll tell him what colors maybe I see. But I also, because we get each other, I also say, hey, listen to the song. And if you feel something different, send it to us, you know? So yeah, it's kind of giving him the space, like, okay, this is what we feel. This is how I see things, but have fun.
Well, tell me this, he sent us like the finals, like, I think we had like 4 or 6 final, you know, ideas to choose from. And we actually settled on 3. So, wow. So we started out with the first image, which is the woman behind the shades and the silhouette. And that, that was the main one. Unfortunately, due to certain folks at a certain DSP, that's a streaming service, a green one, they found there some folks who were listening, because we found out we became a little too popular, objected to the veiled nudity in that track, in that cover art. So we changed it to our secondary choice. And so that's what's on
now. Oh, it's completely changed.
Well, it's a long story, which we really don't need to get into, but it was all changed. We will be going back eventually to our original art. But there's a third one as well. In fact, we should give you all 3. I'm going to get you.
Please, if you don't mind, I would love it.
I'm going to send you a tee of all 3, each of them, and see what's the best.
That would be great.
Yeah. No, the flowers was 3rd.
Oh, the flowers.
That's probably the best one, actually. Yeah.
So basically we work with someone and he just gets it, you know, he's just really great. So
kudos to you. I don't want you to, it doesn't go unnoticed. I think it's really astounding stuff. It really grabs me.
Thank you.
Awesome.
And I didn't want to gloss over this, but you mentioned Tim Palmer earlier, you know? Yeah. He's worked with everybody. One, how did you land him and what did he bring to the table?
Oh, wow.
For you guys,
we landed him through a reference from Universal, and there's a longer story behind that of other, you know, folks who knew him, and everyone went at the same, basically in the same 24-hour period. He's like, hey, you should call Tim Palmer. Hey, you should call Tim Palmer, you know, or let me reach out to Tim Palmer on your behalf, is better said. So that's how that happened, and the relationship was started, I should say. And at that point, it was a matter of sending him, you know, sending him some of our old stuff so he'd get an idea of where the band was coming from, and then sending him a couple new tracks saying, hey, can you just even mix one track? And, you know, the short form is that he was like, well, I'm really busy, but he heard the first track that he'd mixed, which is the song Running Out of Words, which I believe will be our 4th single. And he loved it and said, I'll figure out a way to mix it. So on and so forth. From there, he said, you know, I can mix it.
Actually,
more.
May I just say?
No.
So we were trying other mixers, and nothing quite it didn't make our hearts happy. You know, we weren't just like, yeah, you got it. You know, it was fine. But nothing came back where we were excited about it. So we decided, fuck it, we're just going to mix it ourselves. We don't have a lot of time, but somehow we'll do it. And Kevin came in and we started kind of working
on
it.
Yeah, I forgot about
and
that.
Running, the one that he's talking about, we got fairly done and we're pretty happy about it. You know, felt like, okay, this is a good mix. We're excited. And so we sent that to Tim and he said, ah, I can beat that.
Yeah.
Let me do that. I can beat this. It's fine, but I can beat this.
And one of the things, one of the first couple things he asks was, he said, look, you know, because I asked him what his workflow was like, if you want a lot of involvement. He's in Austin. I said, do you want me to come down there and you know, or a couple of us to come down there? And, you know, within that conversation, he said, no, he said, I'm cool here. We'll just send stuff back and forth. You know, it'd be nice if you're in the studio, but also it can get a little slow. And he said, because I mix very slowly. He said, it can take me up to a week, maybe more sometimes to mix a song. You know, or at least before I get back to it, I may have several things going at once, but he goes, but I'll work on it for a couple hours and step away, do something else, come back. And He said, but may I ask you this? He said, are you comfortable if I hear another idea that could go in there, be it just something as simple as a tambourine or a guitar part or a keyboard part or a background vocal. Even if I call you up and say, hey, can you add this background vocal and I'll maybe give you a scratch idea just to follow along. And I said, you do whatever you want. I said, the only, you know, thing I asked for, we asked for in return is you need to be comfortable with us saying no, even if it's to everything that you put on there and have the mix still work. And he said, absolutely. So he was good with that. We were good. So he had his field day and he brought in a lot of little elements that really aren't so little. They're quite significant. For instance, on our lead off single for the album, Tell Me This, there's a guitar rake in the beginning and bring, I don't know, it's some little odd chord that he layers on top. It's really important to how that chorus hits. There are some subtle background vocals that he actually sang himself. I believe it's the only time he sang on any of the tracks himself. That are in the verses that are sort of haloing my lead vocal.
And so
he did little things like that. You know, he put a lot of tambourine there. We did take tambourine out of a few songs, but you know, but like Tim, you know, Tambo Tim. No, but honestly, it was like what he did with the songs. It was like magic. And as I've said to other, in other,
he got it. He was kind of like Alex with the art. He just got it.
Yeah, it was seamless. I mean, the first draft of running out of words.
Yeah.
It's basically the final draft. Do we make a couple changes after that? Yeah. Changes that I don't even think I would recognize them at this point. But to really tell the story fully, because we were starting to get a little frustrated and you know, the whole process of writing and recording the album was very laborious as it was. But then we were struggling to find the right mixer and we finally get this track back from him and we're holding our breaths. Oh God, is this going to work? Sit down in front of the speakers and Brina had tears in her eyes, you know? And I said that in the Pinfield interview, but she really had tears in her eyes. And someday the world is going to see the video that I took, you know, because I did take a video because it was, for us, it was very momentous. And I told him and he was like, well, you know, it was kind of the same on his end with his family, you know, listening to the song. He really poured his heart and soul into it every step of the way. There was not one moment of just sort of letting it slide or whatever it is. I mean, and I don't mean just with the mixing, even after it was done, when it went to mastering, when I called up and said, should we change this? Or what are your ideas in this? He literally gave it everything he has. And I will remember that to the end of time that he did that, because those little things, you know, even if, no, if people never heard the record, they impact your life. They impact your life. And this year's someone who gave his all the way to the end and then some. And so it makes you want to strive to that level. He set a really high bar. So whatever his background was in life, and I don't mean even just in music, something was instilled in him early on to just give it everything he had. And kudos to him for that, because it really showed.
And it really, you know, when we got the first mix back, the running mix, you know, we were by that point exhausted because it was 6 months every day, pretty much.
Wow.
Every week in the studio. And
we were done with
Julian, he came to the studio with our son every day. It was, we were just completely tapped out emotionally. And then to be faced with this idea of, okay, how are we going to get these mixed, you know? And so when we got it, being emotionally drained, and then just kind of being ready to step away and like have someone get it. And that song is very special. It has so much heart. And so when we got it back from him, you felt the heart. He was able to present it. And it was just beautiful to hear the song as you imagined it, you know, with all the heart that you had imagined
and then some.
It had, and then some. So it was just very powerful. And he did that it wasn't just that one song. Every song we got back, he just understood how it should feel, you know? So it's really, as an engineer, it made a huge impact on me as well, because I had all the heart going in, you know? And I think that we started getting discouraged. Like, is there something we don't get? Like, we feel it's in the tracks. is there something we're not delivering? And so it was really amazing to have another engineer give it back to us and say, no, I get you. And here it is. And it was just really powerful.
That's awesome.
He's one of the best for a reason. I mean, he arguably is probably the best rock and roll engineer out there.
Right, judging by his CV, yeah. I mean, he's worked with a who's who of who. Everybody.
And done a great job of it. And if you notice, I've always found there's one element to someone's resume, so to speak, or discography in this case, that's always very telling. It's repeat customers.
Yeah.
Yep.
You know, there are, everyone's a repeat customer pretty much, unless the artist disbanded, you know, or just went in a completely different direction. Everyone's a repeat customer. That's very telling.
Yeah, for sure. We're at time. Yep. The name of the record is Runaway Emotions. When will it come out? If I may make a suggestion, make it come out like right around the end of school so kids can get it in high school and blast it as they're going out of the parking lot like we used to do.
You know, it's funny because on that note, real quick, we thought we were going to be putting out late spring. And now we're pushing it back simply because these first two singles are doing so well. And
oh, yeah, they are.
And everything's just we're like just pushing out. So realistically, I think it's going to come out in August, sometime by the end of August. Okay. So give or take August 15 to August to September 15. That's my guess. But these days, you don't know. We're just releasing the singles. It will come out as an album. It's just, you know.
Will it be vinyl? You'll have a vinyl record?
We are already everything.
Oh, here,
everything
let me just put the light on.
No, actually, it'll be worse. It'll be worse.
Okay.
Yeah. But we'll be doing vinyl. Everything's all prepped. You know, in fact, we probably will be going to manufacturing really soon here.
What about a tour?
Working on that right now. Yeah. We have our agents looking for us. It's really got to be the right one because we don't want to go out and be with the wrong artist or be. You know, because we're looking for a really good opening slot. And likewise, we're waiting for a little more momentum to build up. It's actually building up real fast. The last few weeks, and for instance, on Spotify alone have been huge for us. Okay. So it's a timing thing too. You know, and we could announce something in a day, a week, a month, but it's definitely coming. We plan to tour relentlessly once we're on the road.
Cool. Well, I will let you go. Your son is home. Yeah. Thank you very much for the time. I appreciate it. Nice to see you again, Peter. Nice to meet
Likewise.
You,
Brina. Hey, email me again. Or email Dana.
Yeah. Yep.
Send your dress and tee sizes. I'm going to send you all three, and we'll send Just Getting Started.
Oh, the Just Getting Started one. That's turned out to be a really cool tee.
Yeah.
Awesome, guys. Thank you very much. Thank you. Enjoy the night.
Yeah.
You too.
Right. I love the African ladies up there, by the way.
I'm sorry.
You've got a poster up there of African ladies.
I do. It's a painting I got in the Dominican Republic last year.
Yeah, I like it.
Thank you.
Right. Yeah, I like the background. You got new places. Cool.
Thank you very much.
All right. Have a good
day. Later. Bye. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well.
Yeah.